You may be seated. We welcome you here today to worship and sing praises to our God and Savior. And so if you're a visitor with us, we thank you for joining us. And if you're an old member like I am, well, we're glad to see you in our pews. All right. The announcements today, the flowers in front of me are, I presume they're the one, provided by Deb Watkins Gunn and Dud Watson in memory of their parents, Vern and Maxine Watkins. And probably those flowers by the piano are from Ted Hartung's funeral on Friday. So other announcements that we have, today at 5 p.m. there's a prayer gathering, and we'd encourage you to attend. On Wednesday, ABW hosts the second half of the showing Esther, and I saw the first half, and I couldn't really believe the big stage production, which was at Branson, of how big the stage was, and all of the animals that they had on that stage. So that's amazing. Our next men's breakfast is July 13th at 8 o'clock. ABW hosts a summer coffee July 10th at 10 a.m. And our next celebration Sunday is July 14th. And I want to call your attention to that endowment board brochure that's on the back ledge there in the windows. And I want to thank Craig Romery for putting that together. And that endowment fund is the reason why we can spend, I think it's $180,000 for a new roof and a new insulation, et cetera. And if there's a bit of dust around, possibly it's due to the fact that it's fallen down here. If you were in here during the week, they have this whole area covered by plastic, and so they're trying to be good stewards of what they do. So that's really good on that. And then the last announcement that I know about that's in there is this One Great Hour of Sharing. And it's quite a story about Ukrainian Baptists and how they're helping in that terrible war that Russia instigated on them. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? If not, then our call to worship. I am using an old Bible to read it because it's not the King James Version that I memorized these first two verses, and Steve said he had several years ago, I talked about him, memorized the same thing, but I didn't have access to a King James, so this is the closest I have. So, I appeal to you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Would you pray with me? Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we ask that you help us in our living to present our lives so that they may be holy and acceptable to you. Guide and protect us so that we will not follow the ways of the world and the many things that it has to offer, but instead be transformed to your world. Help us fill our minds with thoughts so that we will know what is good, pure, acceptable, and perfect to you. We ask this in the holy name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
As you stand, I've asked Joe to come forward and help lead the praise songs. We're going to do something a little different. We're dividing the church right down the center aisle. There are two songs that have an echo. So I'm going to lead the north side, And Joe will lead the south side on the echo part. Let's stand and let's sing.
I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. Who shall I be saved from my enemies?
Who shall I be saved from my enemies?
I will call upon the Lord. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord. Shall I be saved from my enemies? I will call upon the Lord. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I want to do. I give
needs a little work.
Yeah, we're not quite as strong in voice today. We got a few people gone, but it's great to see each of you here today as we worship together. You know, back in 1947, I think it was, way before my time, Billy Graham started his crusades out in California, and they had a tent, and they had sawdust on the floor. Kind of like us today. And there was a phrase called, you know, when you'd walk the sawdust trail. That is, when you'd come to the altar and give your life to Jesus Christ. So if you see a little sawdust today, we're in good company. In fact, I'm feeling a little bit on the pulpit this morning. So great to see each of you here today, and what a great time it always is to come together into the Lord's house. I want to mention a few prayer concerns this morning. First of all, Bob Howe is recovering well at home following his knee replacement surgery this last Monday. He's doing well, and we're grateful and thankful for that. Also, this past week, we lost a beloved person, our oldest person in our congregation by far. She was would have been turning 104 in July. Ann Callahan was 103, just shy of her 104th birthday, and went home to be with the Lord, was placed on hospice a couple weeks ago, and we just want to remember her family now and just pray for them during this time of loss. Her service is going to be on July 12th. That's a Friday, the day before the men's breakfast, for a point of reference. And it will be at 11 o'clock in the morning at Butheris Mazur and Love Funeral Home. The funeral is going to be there. The luncheon is going to be back here in our fellowship hall that day. Okay? So those we'll get that some of that stuff in writing for you, but that's what is going to take place. I didn't find out for sure till yesterday what time the service was, and so I was still waiting on getting that information. Are there any other prayer concerns that we need to remember today? Let's go before the Lord in a time of quietness and prayer. Father, day by day and with each passing moment, you are with us. You are by our side. You love us. And Lord, we're coming before you today to worship you, to honor you, to lift up your name, to sing praises to you for who you are, for loving us when we are undeserving of that love. And Father, we are also, Lord, recognize that every need that we might have, you provide for those needs. Father, we think of those who are going through crisis right now, those who have lost loved ones. We think of the Hartung family, Lord, after having lost Ted this past week. We think as well of the Callahan family, having lost Ann. We continue to ask your blessing, Lord, upon the Shaw family, upon Marilyn Waldron and her family at the loss of her sister. Lord, it has been a time of loss recently, and we just pray for each person who is grieving. We also pray today, Father, that you will be with each person who is going through a health crisis right now. We lift them up to you. We pray that you will bring healing to their bodies. Continue to be with Bob as he recovers from his knee surgery. And Lord, we pray for others who have had long-term health problems. We pray for Peggy Prey. We pray as well for others, Lord, who have needed your help and strength in these last months. God, we thank you for our church, for our congregation, that as we worship you, Lord, that we can turn to you and trust in you for all things. And Lord, today we pray as you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who we pray. Amen. Sorry, I lost my place after all these years.
So this comes from a French opera, and this is the lullaby, so all you old men out there, don't be falling asleep. When we get this, we'll be checking your eyes. I'm ready.
Thank you.
Thank you, Craig. May we stand as we sing a song of deliverance from great distresses. The words are on the screen. Thank you, and be seated.
This time we're going to receive our offering, our opportunity to give generously to the Lord so that the work and the ministry of Jesus Christ can be conducted here and around the world. Let's give generously today.
This past week, I sat down at the piano in the morning and a melody came into my mind, and I thought, well, that may make a good song, except I didn't have any words for it. And so after a very brief prayer, I opened a Anglican hymnal that I have. It just has words in it, but it doesn't have any music. And I just flipped it open, and I was staring at this hymn by Bernard of Cluny, who wrote it in the 12th century, and I understand that the words fit perfectly the melody that I had in my mind. And so it's a meditation on the brevity of our life here and then how we live always in the light of eternity. Brief life is here our portion, brief sorrow, short-lived care. The life that knows no ending, the tearless life is there. Oh, happy retribution, short toil, eternal rest. For mortals and for sinners a mansion with a bliss. There grief is turned to pleasure, such pleasure as below no human voice can utter, and no human heart can know. For he whom now we trust in shall then be seen and known, and they that know and see him shall have him for their own. The morning shall awaken, the shadows shall decay, and each true-hearted servant shall shine as doth the day. Then all the halls of Zion shall be complete, and in the land of beauty all things of beauty meet. Their God, our King and portion in fullness of his grace, shall we behold forever and worship face to face. Their God, our King and portion in fullness of his grace, shall we behold forever and worship face to face.
Father God, it is with gratitude that we bring before you these tithes and these offerings, that they be used, Lord, for the work and the ministry of your kingdom here on this earth. We ask, God, that you will bless those who are giving out of the generosity of their hearts, that they might be blessed by you in the fullness of your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Today's scripture comes from, again, Revelation chapter 3, verses 7 through 13. To the angel in the church in Philadelphia write, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and not denied my name. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars. I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come on the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. The one who is victorious, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will they leave it. I will write on them the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God, and I will also write on them my new name. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches.
I will open a door that you cannot shut. There's a story about a guy who happened to be visiting a friend who took him on took him to this old one-room church building in the backwoods of Arkansas. He didn't realize what kind of church it was until the minister started pulling rattlesnakes out of a burlap bag and passing them one by one down from person to person down the aisle. The visitor had never seen anything quite like this before, and he certainly wasn't interested in somebody handing him a snake. Frantically, he began turning one way and then the other, looking for a way out of this place. But the only exit he could see was up past the preacher who was passing out the snakes. Turning to the guy next to him, he said, "Where's the back door? I've got to get out of here." And the man answered, "We ain't got one." "All right then," the visitor said, "where would you like one?" That man was willing to open a whole new door to that church, wasn't he? In our text today, we find Jesus telling the church at Philadelphia, "I am willing to open a whole new door for you." This is our sixth week now in this study on the seven churches of Asia Minor. We find in Revelation chapters 2 and 3. We've taken a brief look at five other churches and cities that had likely been evangelized by the Apostle Paul. And we're now well into their first few decades of growth, and even to the point where they were declining. It seems like every church has a path of growth and decline, and that seems to be the lifespan of a congregation. This particular church had endured persecution, or I should say this particular group of churches, had had persecution. They had cultural pressure from around them to live a certain way and to do a certain thing, and there was all kinds of religious intolerance going on in their communities. And within the church itself, there was a certain amount of apathy. People stopped caring in some of these congregations. Jesus told the Ephesian church that they did good deeds, but they had lost their first love, of course, being Jesus Christ. He told the Smyrna church that they were rich in good works and that he actually held nothing against them. One of the few churches that is the case. And then he told the church at Pergamum that they had been tolerating the worship of foreign and pagan gods, and it was not to be tolerated. He told the church at Thyatira that they had tolerated a woman in the church who had influenced people, and that woman he gave that name Jezebel, after the Old Testament wicked queen. And fifthly, look, last week we talked about the struggles of Sardis and how that they were referred to as being a dead church. What they were doing was worthless, as if they were completely dead. And today we look at the Church of Philadelphia. The city of Philadelphia, not the one in Pennsylvania, of course, was situated about 25 miles southeast of Sardis, the next town that a courier who was carrying the message from John to them was actually would have been the next stop on the route on the seven churches of Asia Minor. Philadelphia was founded about 159 BC as a center of Greek language and culture in that particular region. It was designed and situated in a place where it would bring the glory of ancient Greece to all of Asia Minor. It was renowned for its temples and its vineyards and its cultural festivals, and for this reason it was nicknamed Little Athens. Now I'm sure you know this, but Philos is a Greek word that means love or affection. And Adolphos means brother. So Philadelphia means a city of brotherly love. Let me remind you again that although John is the writer, and Jesus is actually the voice of the second and third chapters of Revelation. Christ himself is speaking to the churches. For example, here in verse 7, Christ introduces himself as the one who is holy and true. It so happens that this is a familiar Jewish title for God, the one who is holy and true. And they would have understood this. The Jewish people in that community would have understood this. In Isaiah 53, God declares, "I am the Lord your God, the Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King." Holiness itself is attributed to God and God alone by the Jewish people. And I should mention that here at Philadelphia, they were surrounded by a large community of Jewish people. Jesus also says that he is the true one. In the original language, it's Anathanos. The word means something that is real and genuine and authentic, something that is true. In Jesus, we find reality. When we consider him, we're confronted with absolute truth. He is real. In his hand is the key of David. Jesus is our Messiah, the son of David, the king of Israel. And so it mentions in that passage about being the key of David. So Jesus tells this struggling church at Philadelphia, "I know that you have little strength." The city had little strength as it was slowly recovering. The city itself, not just the church, but the city itself was recovering from an earthquake that devastated the area just a few years earlier in AD 17. So this little church has been persecuted by the Jews living in that area. There was a large and powerful Jewish community, as I had said earlier, that lived in Philadelphia. And Jesus refers to them in this passage as the synagogue of Satan. He calls them this because they had not only rejected the Messiah, but they violated the covenant laws by showing hatred toward the Christians and persecuting them. Jesus implies in verse 9 that the believers that live in Philadelphia have been excluded and locked out of the synagogue, that the door had been shut, but he says the door of salvation has been flung widely open to them. The Jewish leaders viewed the Christian church as a threat to their faith. This is kind of sad and ironic, I think, for the most Jewish thing that you can do, really, is to believe in Jesus because he is the Messiah, and yet he is rejected. Jesus says that the synagogue of leaders are not true Jews. And Paul explains in Romans chapter 2, Paul says, a man is not a Jew if he is the only one outwardly. No, a man is a Jew if he is one inwardly. And then in Galatians, he calls the Christian church the Israel of God. And he states, if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. This means that the day that I become a Christian, I also become a Jew. Now, we don't think of it in those terms. We know that today there's an awful lot of anti-Semitism that's going on around the world and in places and in our own country and different places. We're seeing it kind of raise its ugly head once again. But we don't think of ourselves as being Jews, but at least in the spiritual sense, we are children of God in the same way that the Jews are children of God. Jesus makes us kosher, if you will. There is no criticism or correction in this letter that is written to the church at Philadelphia. There's only praise and encouragement and promise of things to come. In verse 10, the church is to be rewarded for enduring patiently through these trials. We know from history that the church in Philadelphia stood firm throughout the Muslim invasion that took place centuries later until the city was finally destroyed, fell to the Turks in 1392. That's a long existence for this city, probably one of the longest existence of any city in the world. Jesus promises to keep the church from the hour of trial. What does that mean? Passage is actually a little bit confusing, I think. What does it mean to be kept from the hour? Many Christians take this specific phrase written to the Christians at Philadelphia, and they interpret it to mean that when the rapture comes, us Christians will be raptured up before the great tribulation comes, and they will not have to suffer the terrible period of time known as the tribulation. That system of beliefs is called dispensationalism and was started by John Nelson Darby about 1830, and it continues on to today in certain realms of Christian teaching. But that's a little bit of a stretch, I think, to take one verse that was written to the Philadelphian church and to say that it applies to all, that it applies to us as Christians today, to all people. Early church historians tell us that this church at Philadelphia continued to suffer. It didn't get easier for them, but rather that they persevered through that time of suffering. They survived. I want you to notice two phrases from today's text that stand out. The first is in verse 8, where it says, I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Sometimes we feel like we don't have a lot of strength. After the week that I've had this last week, I don't feel like I have much strength. It's one of those kinds of weeks. And over the years, I've complimented a church member about their faith. I've said to somebody in the congregation, you seem to be a person of such strong faith. And quite often the response that I get back is, but I don't feel like my faith is very strong. I don't feel like I'm such a strong Christian. In fact, I really feel quite weak at times. You'd probably be the first to tell me that you feel weak in your faith. We sometimes feel beaten down because of circumstances that surround us, situations that devastate us. A rebellious child may make you feel like you have failed as a Christian. If you had one of your children were rebellious, you probably ask yourself, where did we go wrong? Well, I must be a terrible parent. You might feel guilt about something that you said to a coworker at work, and you thought after the words, man, I shouldn't have said that. I must really be a lousy Christian to say something like that. Maybe your marriage isn't what it ought to be. And so you feel like you've failed as a witness for Christ in your marriage. Or maybe you feel like your habits of prayer are weak and frail and you can hardly utter the words sometimes of praying. Maybe you've even questioned God over certain tragedies in life and say, I'm not so sure God even exists if God would allow something like this to happen. And then later on, you feel guilt about what you said and what you were thinking at the time. You ask yourself, what kind of Christian does that, says that? But like the church at Philadelphia, even when you feel like you're weak and fragile, you keep true to God's calling in your life. You don't let it slip away from you. You look with confidence and trust to Christ, and you go on with life. What are the words to that song? The other day, we at the graveside of Ted Hartung, it just kind of came to me, and I at the end of the service, I just broke out in chorus of, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And we sang a couple verses of that song. And like that words in that song, I am weak, but he is strong. And how true that is. I think it's such an act of grace that when we are experiencing our weakest point in our lives, that God steps forward. He shares his love in such visible and tangible ways. When we're ready to give up, God steps in and gives us hope. Puts somebody in our path to encourage us, to protect us from the things that we are most afraid of. And of course, the second phrase that I want to draw your attention to is actually in verse 10. Since you have kept my command to endure patiently. That's part of that passage that you see there in front of you. Words of encouragement to a suffering church who probably want to give up at times, but they kept on going. They endured through that time. My hope today, as we have heard these words to the church at Philadelphia, is that we will live with endurance. Paul writes to Timothy shortly before his death. He says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not to me only, but to all who have longed for his appearing. I love that passage. I believe that these words today in Revelation are the words of encouragement that are not only to the church at Philadelphia, but to all of us as well. And I want to encourage you who are young and working at a job you don't particularly like, but you keep on trudging on, that you might be facing financial hardship every day because the right job hasn't come along. I want to encourage you who are well past your employment years, which is probably most people here. But now you face the uncertainty of health problems in your life. And yes, now there's aches and pains, and middle age has turned into excruciating pain in your twilight years. And maybe you miss out on some of the conversations because your hearing isn't quite what it once was. Or maybe you miss out on the beauty of a new grandchild because your eyesight is failing. The words of encouragement here are for you as well. As a pastor, I've sat at the side of older people who've lived life faithfully for Christ throughout their entire lives. But now it's become a little difficult to cope with the physical limitations, and it's actually caused them to spiritually struggle. There's a correlation there, that if we're struggling physically, if we become depressed, if we become discouraged, that it affects our spiritual life. We can remember these words in Revelation 3, verse 8. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. It hurts me to see you hurting. But I too am reminded of the Apostle Paul as he nears the finish line. And someday Jesus is going to take each one of us, one by one, in his arms as we enter his presence. And he's going to say, well done, thou good and thou faithful servant. Amen. We're going to close today by singing Whiter Than Snow, 436. I want you to notice, to me, this is one of my favorite hymns because of the words. The words are absolutely incredible to this song. As we stand today, as we sing these words, I hope that they touch your heart and that they are an act of worship to the Lord. Let's stand together as we sing. If you do not know Christ as your Savior, I hope that you invite Christ into your life. If you want to join in the membership, the fellowship of Second Baptist, I hope that today that you will make that decision to meet me here at the front, and let's do that.